Hello and welcome to today's Hutchins Center's Fellows Colloquium. Susanna Ashton will be presenting her book in progress, A Plausible Man, The Life of John Andrew Jackson. Susanna Ashton is professor of English at Clemson University. Her scholarship focuses on notions of authentication and identity in narratives of slavery and freedom. She is the author and editor of numerous award-winning books, including Collaborators in Literary America, 1870-1920, co-edited with Rhonda R. Thomas, The South Carolina Roots of African-American Thought, and co-edited with William Hardwick, Approaches to Teaching the Works of Charles W. Chestnut. Her groundbreaking research on 19th century literary culture, authorship, and African-American life writing has been supported by Yale's Gilda Lehrman Center, Harvard's Houghton Library, the American Printing History Society, and a Fulbright, among many other fellowships and awards. So please welcome Professor Ashton.
Welcome, Professor. I'm so very excited. It's good to see you.
Hi there. Well, I guess I'll get going. As I get started, I want to say first thank you to Skip and Abby and Tom and Krishna and all the Hutchins Center coordinators and staff and my fellows who've been so supportive and welcoming. Also, a shout out to my colleagues at my home university in South Carolina who are carrying burdens because I'm not there, and I am well aware of that and appreciative. And also a lot of museums and archives over four countries and seven states, and just an unspeakable number of librarians and reference experts have been helping me over the years. Also, I don't want to call them out immediately, but we're very lucky to have a descendant of John Andrew Jackson is in the audience today, and I really feel honored appreciative of the trust of the descendants' families, both on the descendants of John Andrew Jackson and of his in the enslavers' family, the English family descendants, who I'm also in touch with, and their support has been incredibly valuable, irreplaceable, really, for this project. So I'm a scholar of English. I'm a scholar of narrative. I do history. I am certainly doing historical work. I am acting as a historian in that way. But ultimately, I'm interested in witness. I'm interested in how we tell our stories, what we tell, what we don't tell, what narratives are included, how we shape our stories. And when we can't speak, how we are spoken for by others or how we speak of others. I'm interested in what actually Barbara McCaskill the other week referred to as a methodology of community. And as you'll see, that comes out in my work. Another framing point for this discussion for me today is notions of the archive. In my book project, each chapter centers on close reading of one document. Maybe it's census, maybe it's a letter, maybe it's a receipt, and how it unpacks John Andrew Jackson moving through time, but also a broader history of witness for us. So, and my final thought is, years ago, this project's been going for about 10 years now, 11 maybe, many years ago, this project got some attention because I discovered that John Andrew Jackson, shall we say, crossed paths with the author and novelist Harriet Beecher Stowe at a very powerful and interesting moment. During my talk today, I'm really gonna just give that a couple of minutes. But if we want to talk about that further in the Q&A, we can return to that incident or to any other incidents in his very broad, crazy, and surprising life. And I'm trying to move my slides and they're not quite moving. So, oh, there we go. Okay. So first of all, John Andrew Jackson, you've probably never heard of him. That's okay. He was featured in two collected editions of books I did. He wrote a narrative of his life, and I featured it in my South Carolina Slave Narratives book, also in the South Carolina Roots of African American Thought. But his narrative, which has gotten almost no attention from anybody, has really haunted me ever since. It was published in 1862. This is, of course, the primary source of my information about the early years of John Andrew Jackson. It was published in England, and it really never went anywhere. He had a falling out with the press that I'll tell you about. But you can see there, you can already get a sense of his personality. He's wearing checkered pants, a vest, a hat, a tie. Believe me, this is not what he really would have been wearing in the cotton fields of Sumter, South Carolina as he escaped. But he's selling an image. And he was a snappy, charismatic, powerful man. And that's sort of clearly part of the story he's trying to tell here. He opens his narrative very simply, pointing out, I was born in South Carolina. My grandfather was stolen from Africa. My father learned the African method of curing snake bites and was, in consequence, called Dr. Clavern. Dr. Clavern, I won't be talking about him much, but he actually, Dr. Clavern was the connection that brought me to Jackson's family. Jackson's family is called the Clavon family descendants, are the ones I've been in touch with. And the name Doctor actually became a first name. His father ended up registering to vote under the name Doctor, and many descendants of various generations of that family have been called Doctor, including one delightful young man I met who was in graduate school in engineering, and he is now Doctor Doctor. So Doctor is part of the legacy of achievement and dignity from Dr. Clavern in Africa that is passed along. So let me give you a brief overview of like a first, shall we say, chunk of his life. And then I'll go to some salient moments. He was born in Sumter, South Carolina, near Black Creek. Remember that name. He was enslaved by the English family. He married Louisa, a young woman from an adjacent plantation, and they had at least one child, a daughter named Ginny or Jenny. His wife is forcibly remarried and sent off to Georgia with little Ginny. Jackson is, of course, heartbroken, devastated. He has nothing left to lose. And he flees on horseback around Christmas, 1846. He makes it some 180 miles to Charleston, South Carolina, on the coast. He then smuggles himself aboard a Boston-bound vessel in February of 1847. Here you can see Sumter County. You get a sense, for those of you who don't know the Carolinas, that it's quite inland. It's quite deep country. The house above is where the enslavers of Louisa lived. And the house below is where the enslavers of John Andrew Jackson lived. The English family house is no longer there, although I'll show you that picture of the land, what's happened to it. But the house where the Louisa's enslavers is still there. I went and knocked one day, but nobody answered. So that conversation is yet to happen someday. John Andrew Jackson, when speaking of his engaged, the family, the English family, he spends a great two or three chapters in his book talking about the violence and terror his family experienced at the hands of Robert English and that particular generation of that family. He says, I myself was willed to that tyrant, but God had willed me to myself. Here's an 1845 deed of trust giving over Louisa and Ginny to a law family relative. And again, I feel it's very powerful to actually see these documents. So my apologies if some of my my little Photoshop highlights and stuff isn't quite at the caliber I wish they could be, but it gives you a sense of what these pieces of paper mean. I unpacked the advertisement by going through a lot of Charleston newspapers over the years and found Jackson's, the advertisement, the Reverend Thomas R. English, a Presbyterian reverend of some renown, had put out for his family, advertising for Jackson. One salient detail here is by the time this advertisement had come out, Jackson was already in Massachusetts, I'm pleased to say. Nice to see they're looking in totally the wrong direction. They're looking for him, of course. Jackson is about 30 years of age, near 6 feet in height, stout and well-proportioned, has high and marked temples, speaks plausibly, has a wife in Houston County, Georgia, belonging to Mr. J.R. McLaw, whither he may have gone, the above reward will be paid, blah, blah, blah. As a scholar of language, a scholar of English, I'd like to linger here, but I probably won't, on Speaks Plausibly, which is, of course, the title, at least the working title of my book. Speaks Plausibly is a kind of phrase not uncommon in advertisements for humans that you would see in newspapers of the time. But it also implies, right, that he is a charismatic talker. He can talk his way out of problems, but because he is himself devoid of reason, devoid of humanity, devoid of the depth of truth and honor, that anything he says would therefore be implausible, is fake. He has no core humanity from whence he originates reason, right? That's a powerful thought we have. But the Speak Plausibly that I think about that fuels the title of my work is, of course, he's a self-fashioned man, as you shall see. He gets to the docks of Charleston, and he tries to sort of hang out there for a few weeks. He's trying to figure out a boat that he can get on. He's trying to earn a little bit of money if he can. He's trying to pretend that he is a enslaved person who's been hired out to work the docks. And he manages to fake it for a few weeks. But he's confronted on the docks by someone who asks, "Who do you belong to?" I answered, "I belong to South Carolina. It was none of their business whom I belonged to. I was trying to belong to myself." I'm beginning to get a sense of his wry personality here. The "I belong to South Carolina" is a nonsensical answer, really. Although again, I took that for a title of one of my other books. But it tells you he's trying to talk his way out of problems. He's trying to sort of bluff his way into sort of disconcerting people so that they back off. And it worked. But he realizes at this moment, he does not have a slave badge. Slave badges were particular to a couple of coastal cities, primarily Charleston, a little bit Beaufort, a little bit Savannah. And in the 1840s, an enslaved person would need one of these badges. They were supposed to be either on your clothing or around your neck, but you could possibly carry them in your pocket, but you had to produce them. And if you didn't have them, you could be thrown into jail. And of course, then in Jackson's case, re-enslaved. He realizes he doesn't have a slave badge and he has got to get out of there. He cannot linger in Charleston. And he manages to smuggle himself aboard a boat between several bales of cotton. For those of you who don't know what a bale of cotton, I'm pulling out this photo. I'm estimating that child is about 4.5 feet tall. Gives you a sense of how large they would have been. And he manages to sort of get down into the hold of a boat between two or three bales of cotton. He brings with him water, some food, a big cloak, and his only tool is a gimlet, which ends up he uses to drill holes for air. Okay, the next thing that happens is he's on board the ship for a couple of days. He runs out of food, he runs out of water. He feels he's dying. He has to let himself be known, and he sort of lets the sailors find him. But he is very fortunate that this particular boat, the Smyrna, has a number of Black sailors aboard. And these Black sailors are our heroes in my mind, Frank, Jim Jones, and Dennis. He names them, and I like to call out their names. And Frank, Jim Jones, and Dennis persuade the captain to not turn him in, although the captain's pretty nervous about it. And they say, we'll make this problem go away, right? We'll just, you won't have to even think about this. They get to Boston and they take him to Henry Foreman's boarding house in Boston, boarding house for colored seamen. Henry Foreman is another, I'd like, there's a book to be written just about Henry Foreman someday, I tell you. He's a free man of color in Boston, and he's running a boarding house in the most rough and tumble area down near the docks in what's now the North End. And it's a temperance house, and he takes in Black sailors, Black seamen. He and his wife and their child run this business. And later we see Andrew Jackson, at that point he's not fully using John Andrew, is listed in the census. Just in case I was wondering, was it this boarding house? Was it Andrew Jackson? Indeed, we see on the next page, Dennis is another sailor of 23 years age, Black, listed of unknown origins, living alongside John Andrew Jackson and Henry Forman. Jackson appreciates the friendship and security. He stays with Henry Forman, and he talks about Henry Forman in his memoir. Years later, Henry Forman comes back, well, 2 years later, Henry Forman comes back into the story, and I'll tell you how. All right, here's another chunk. John Andrew Jackson, he works in a tannery in Salem. It's pretty horrible work, I'm sure, but he's pleased with it. It earns him, he thinks, a fair wage. He even has a little time at night to start sawing wood, earn a extra money. And he realizes he needs to start raise money to save Louisa and Jenny, right? Who are still down in Georgia. He is, of course, endlessly energized by the terror and desperation to free his wife and child. He somehow starts speaking in public. He doesn't start speaking in Salem or Boston, as far as I can tell, but he receives advice about going out to Worcester and Springfield, and he spends some time in Northampton giving talks. He's forced to flee, however. He begins to accumulate a little bit of money. I'll tell you more about that in a minute. But he's forced to flee in 1850 in September when the Fugitive Slave Act passes and renders the life of any fugitives in Massachusetts intolerably dangerous and precarious. This time, unlike his first escape, which was completely seeking freedom on his own accord and taking all the danger on himself, this time he is assisted somewhat by a network of Underground Railroad activists, both Black and white. He is hidden in Maine for a night by Harriet Beecher Stowe. I'll tell you about that in December of 1850. By spring, he makes it to Canada. He hears that his first wife has passed away, and so he remarries Julia Ann Watson Jackson, a woman who's a fugitive from North Carolina herself. So the best Massachusetts, I was fortunate, there's a cache of letters at the wonderful American Antiquarian Society written about John Andrew Jackson, and one letter by John Andrew Jackson, well, dictated by him at that point, including Black and white activists, including Henry Highland Garnett. I was able to identify an anonymous letter that was certainly by Henry Highland Garnett written on Jackson's behalf, the Reverend Osgood, Lucy Chase, and others. These are letters where they're saying, you know, they're collecting money for Jackson, but just collecting money, think about it, it's actually incredibly logistically difficult to free anybody, right? To purchase someone's freedom. To begin with, you have bad faith people in the South who are willing to take your money and not actually liberate somebody. Are they really willing to deal? Are they going to set a fair price? Of course not. Are they going to be as problem, you know, what are the incentives for fair dealing? And then how are you even going to send somebody South, perhaps to escort people back up, right? There are many, many logistical challenges here, which I think are really not discussed often when people in these narratives of people trying to help their family. So the logistics here are very complicated. He's making progress. And he gets a hostile letter returned from the South by a neighbor of the English family, who writes with just cruelty. You can say to him that he need not stop short of $800, as less than that amount will not purchase his wife and child. And so Andrew and his friends must stir themselves and contribute liberally, or else he will never be able to see his family. Poor Andrew Jackson. Sort of the cloying sarcasm and cruelty. It then goes into several paragraphs talking about misguided abolitionist thought in this horrible letter. But the letter actually validates Jackson's story. He's been able to wave around this horrible letter to other people and say, look, you know, this actually validates everything I said. He's not really willing to deal, but he's aware of my wife and child. This is, you know, an affidavit of my truth. And this letter is reprinted in a Northampton newspaper and then reprinted in the Liberator. So I begin to get a real sense of this transaction. And Jackson's becoming more and more sophisticated as he learns all the maneuvers here. And then he goes up to Maine. And in Maine, he gives me one sentence, really. I may mention that during my flight from Salem to Canada, I met with a very sincere friend and helper who gave me refuge during the night and set me on my way. Her name was Mrs. Beecher Stowe. She took me in and fed me and gave me some clothes and $5. She also inspected my back, which is covered with scars, which I shall carry with me to the grave. She listened with great interest to my story, sympathized with me when I told her how long I had been parted from my wife, Louisa, and my daughter, Jenny, and perhaps forever. That's really all I have. And I read that and I thought, Jackson, you know, Harriet Beecher Stowe was the, I don't know, the Stephen King, the most popular, well-known, well, writer, you know, in America in the 19th century. He just wanted a little of her celebrity. Maybe he met her briefly. He's exaggerating. I wasn't really sure what to make of this, but I looked into it and discovered there was a lot more to this story. And then actually he had written her, he had visited, Spence visited, he had hidden with her before she had written Uncle Tom's Cabin, before she was well-known. He had no incentive to brush shoulders with a celebrity at that point in time. So I'm just gonna give you a minute on the Stowe encounter here. This is the Harriet Beecher Stowe house in Brunswick, Maine, currently owned by Bowdoin. It was falling apart, and thanks in part to my work recovering this as an Underground Railroad site with the unprecedented duplicative primary source documentation, it's now been saved. So Harriet Beecher Stowe wrote a letter to her sister, which is in held at Yale right now. And she's talking about a neighbor. And she says, my neighbor and I had over the tea table the other night, a sort of argument which consists in both sides saying over and over just what they said before. When I asked him flatly if he would obey the law, supposing a fugitive came to him, Mrs. Upham laughed and he hemmed and hawed, and little Mary Upham broke out, I wouldn't, I know. Well, the next day there comes along a fugitive bound for Canada, and Smith sends him right up to Professor Upham, who takes him in his study and hears his story and gives him a dollar, and Mrs. Upham puts in bountifully in the provision line. And then he comes here for lodging. This is all still Harriet Beecher Stowe with this unnamed fugitive writing to her sister. Now our beds were all full, and before this law passed, I might have tried to send him somewhere else. As it was, all hands in the house united in making him up a bed in our waste room. And Henry and Freddie and Georgie seemed to think they could not do too much for him. They hung around him and seemed never tired of hearing him talk and sing. He was a genuine article from the old Caroline state. And when I read this, I realized it couldn't be anyone but Jackson. You have the charisma of the singing and talking. It exactly aligns with the time he said he visited, with the experience he had with them, meeting all the children. And also the last line, he was an old genuine article from the old Caroline state. And Stowe puts the quotes around that like that. She's referencing a minstrel song that was very popular from 1847 called Dearest May. And I noted that because in his own memoir, Jackson includes the entire lyrics to Dearest May in his memoir. And then later on, even in the 1890s, Jackson is quoting Dearest May. It clearly was his favorite song, or one of his favorites. All right, the shoot me is here. Note in this version, it's using the N-word. When Jackson writes the lyrics of the song in his own book, he refers to now Freeman listened to me, a story I'll relate. But this is clearly sort of the popular reference, again, tying Stowe and Jackson together. Leaving Stowe behind, because this isn't her story. She did 7 weeks later, 7 weeks, start to write Uncle Tom's Cabin. And again, as a scholar of American literature and intertextuality, we could spend a lot of time talking about the potential knowledge she learned from Jackson, how that shaped some of the stories, particularly the story of people, a senator who would have turned away fugitive slaves in principle, but when he meets a fugitive, brings them into his house and his heart. But again, this is Jackson's story and the way in which these encounters created his witness. So I'm gonna move to Portland, Maine, which was his next stop. He stayed there for a couple of weeks, sponsored financially by Samuel Fessenden, a white lawyer. Anyone who's interested in the Liberty Party, he's a Liberty Party candidate for governor, very prominent white activist. But Jackson's actually hiding with Black families in Portland along the docks. Almost certainly, he was supported by the Abyssinian Meeting House, the center of Black life in Portland. Jackson makes it a couple of weeks, probably about 2-3 months later, he makes it into Canada. And this is the kind of document, I'm gonna give you two or three examples that I have a whole chapter really about this odd piece of paper. This is an 1851 census of New Brunswick, Canada. I'm a bit of a census nerd. And this piece of paper is bizarre. It's an addendum to the regular census. There are Black people living in New Brunswick, Canada. It's a maritime city, but they're listed by address, just the way everybody else in the census is listed according to their address. But this addendum lists 11 people on a separate page as Blacks. And most interestingly, and I can't really zone in on it, but there's a column called race. And in this 1851 census, these 11 people are listed as race, United States, right? Because they are, and we forget, people talk very blithely about fugitives making it across the border into Canada. To begin with, they weren't necessarily welcomed or appreciated there. There were some horrible situations where there were indeed enslaved people or formerly enslaved people who were sent back to the United States for various reasons. Their welcome there was very unsure. And they were also of very unclear legal status. Are they refugees? Is that language we want to use? Here you see a census taker trying to figure it out, not wanting to list them as refugees, not wanting to list them as enslaved people, but they're not quite regular immigrants. Now, Jackson only gives me like three sentences about his life in Canada. He says, I went to Canada, I worked as a whitewasher, and I married Julia, and then I left. That's all I know. But looking at back at this page, there was a name there, which was Cornelius Sparrow, was one of the 11 people. And the name Cornelius Sparrow is so beautifully unique. I was able to learn about Cornelius Sparrow, a man listed only two lines away from John Andrew Jackson. Cornelius Sparrow was a free Black man in Boston who had a wife who was a fugitive, I think from Virginia or Maryland. Cornelius Sparrow got involved in a big legal case in Boston. Massachusetts Vigilance Committee in 1850, after the Fugitive Slave Act, gave Cornelius Sparrow money to go up to Canada. And I think he was on the same boat and the same sort of, you know, grouping that came in to from Portland, Maine to New Brunswick. And I noticed Sparrow is very trackable. Jackson, I don't know much about what happened to him, but he's part of a community, right? You have to look at the other people at the page again and again. It's the entire page which the story emerges. Sparrow manages to open a restaurant. Sparrow is a successful businessman. He sells oysters for many years. He's well known in Brunswick, in New Brunswick, Canada, in St. John. And he also, I noticed, started a whitewashing business. It's the only whitewashing business I ever saw advertised anywhere in the newspapers in St. John. I went through it very thoroughly. And I know, and it seems almost inescapable that, again, Jackson was working with Sparrow as the only Black man running a business in all of St. John, Canada, whitewashing. I even saw, to my delight, that John Andrew Jackson claimed his citizenship in Canada. He registered to vote in 1852. And note also that in this list, people are not marked by race. I mean, there's plenty of, believe me, St. John, they wouldn't let Black people live in the center of the city. They wouldn't let them work in lots of professions. I mean, legally, not just by general prejudice. There are lots of difficult challenges people of color had in St. John, but they were allowed to vote and to register. And there you see John Andrew Jackson, 1852, clearly planning a life as a Canadian. But things take a turn. And the next thing I know, Jackson is on a boat to England. He travels with his second wife, Julia. He starts giving lectures. He's now become somewhat literate. I don't think he's fluent, but it's around his time in England, I start seeing things that are in his actual writing. So he learned to read and write as an adult. And I I know I speak quickly. I'm from Brooklyn. I'm going to take a breath here at just the enormity of someone learning to read and write as an adult. He gives over 50 independent lectures in Scotland and England over about a 9-year period. He's trying to raise money to purchase other, his father, he says, and his niece and nephew. This is important. He's not formally sponsored by anybody. He's not part of the anti-slavery, any anti-slavery group, any particular church group, but he does find a unique ally. So he's not moving in the circles of Frederick Douglass exactly. He's overlapping. He's not moving along with Henry Box Brown, but he's overlapping. Like he's sort of got this really independent trajectory, which is why he's been completely overlooked from people who are not looking at these sort of independent speakers. He hooks up finally with the Reverend Spurgeon at this huge London tabernacle. And with Spurgeon's help, Jackson publishes The Experience of a Slave in South Carolina. He has a falling out with Spurgeon and publishes a furious screed. The Reverend Spurgeon is a conservative Baptist icon. He was known as the Prince of Preachers. It is estimated that in his lifetime, Spurgeon preached to about 10 million people. He was unquestionably the best known Baptist of the 19th century and is a revered figure in the conservative Baptist tradition worldwide. Now, this is important because the Baptists in England were not known for, Garrison was a Baptist, old Baptist tradition in America is a different thing. But in England, the Baptists were not on the forefront of progressive activism in any way, in this particular, this very conservative mode. Spurgeon never spoke on American slavery. And I went through a lot of concordances at Bob Jones University, which is, they have all you need to know about Spurgeon there. And he really never spoke about American slavery in his life until he met Jackson. He invited Jackson to speak at the Metropolitan Tabernacle in London. I really wanted to show you that picture to let you think about a man who came from Lynchburg, South Carolina, Black Creek, Sumter, the depths of the cotton field on the plantation labor camps, to then speak in one of the most hallowed and enormous spaces in London. The tabernacle is still there. The Nazis bombed it badly. So you have this facade, the back is entirely shattered and new and replaced. You can get a sense, again, this is as it would have looked. This was built before Jackson got there. So you can see the front of the building looks as Jackson would have entered it to speak. In the British census, compare this a little bit to the Canadian one I showed you. Here, there is no statement about race at all. He and his wife show up, they're working, and they're listed as from South Carolina as a lady's maid and a laborer. But they're not listed by race. When I look again, I'm always looking at everyone on the page, methodology of community. And mostly it seems to be very poor, but not the worst, shall we say. It seems to be a lot of Irish immigrant people living on sort of this block that he and his wife ended up on. Spurgeon's people help him publish a book, and Jackson continues his lectures. He ends up, though, having a huge conflict with Spurgeon. Basically, he thinks money has been collected on his behalf and not been turned over to him to buy his father. And this pamphlet is in the New York Public Library in sort of miscellaneous pamphlets. It is falling apart. Big parts of the pages are missing. And it's also sort of frantic and furious. In it, he says, Spurgeon is a hypocrite. He has alcohol in the basement and he took my money and he's a racist and everybody there, they say they like the black people, but they don't. And they said they were going to help me read and I could attend Sunday school. But when I actually showed up, they wouldn't let me have any textbooks and, really pointed, furious. And it's sort of a scattered argument. But it actually speaks to testify to his literacy, because I think no well-educated editor would have written anything as this sort of frantic and furious. He must have spent a lot of money getting this printed. He also doomed himself in London. You do not go publishing anti-Spurgeon screeds in London, expect to get a job anytime soon. So no, not surprisingly, about a year later, the Civil War ends and Jackson and his wife get on the first boat out of London. He ends up back in Salem, Massachusetts, working informally with the Freedmen's Bureau and raising money for destitute freedmen and women. He settles in Springfield, Massachusetts in 1866. This is a whirlwind. I know I'm dumping a lot of info very fast. He appears to be based in Springfield. Then he moves to New Haven, then back to Springfield, then back to New Haven. Basically, there's a river, the Connecticut River. And I began to realize he's in Springfield, Hartford, and New Haven, back and forth. And all these cities are sort of right on the river, and he's moving between them. And then he's also going down to South Carolina. Here I have a lecture he gave. Not only is this lecture telling us he was speaking in Salem in 1867, what's interesting too is, right, it's a form. He clearly had a bunch of them that you would fill in for various different occasions. So although this is the only one I have from 1867, he clearly would have had this ready to advertise different talks as well. He goes, now, there's a lot of work that's insightful and informative and rich with detail about people who survived slavery and wrote narratives about their lives. But there's not always as rich a narrative about what happens after the Civil War. So for me, in many ways, some of the hardest things I've been doing, but the most compelling things, is what to do for the next 35 or 40 years of Jackson's life and how he chooses to live it and how the archive changes. He speaks, again, he's still lecturing for the next 35 years. He shows up in newspapers. I don't know his speeches, but I know people paraphrasing it and advertising it. He's speaking on miscegenation. He's against it. He's speaking on the history of slavery. He's speaking on the plight of the freedmen. He's speaking on exodusters, going to Kansas. He's taking on all different causes. Although again, most of them are about raising money for the plight of the freemen, how to collect money, food, clothing, plows, tools. I believe he may have been reunited with Louisa when he went down south. The historical record's a little sketchy, but I have some indication that Louisa survived and would have moved back to the South Sumter County area. She would have remarried and had family. Again, I'm not 100% sure, but it helps explain why for the next 35 years, Jackson's going between South Carolina and New England. I think he has multiple families, which was, you know, a tragic truth that people were very careful about speaking about, but of course was the, you know, part of the pain of the situation of the freed people in the post-Civil War era. I'm gonna take a minute to tell you about what I'm calling the gristmill scheme, because it tells you about Jackson, community, archive, and perhaps reparations. Jackson, when he was in Maine, I mentioned he had become friendly with Fessenden, a prominent supporter of the Liberty Party. Fessenden was also, his whole family moved closely with the Howard family in Maine. The O.O. Howard, who was a hero of the Civil War, became the head of the Freedmen's Bureau. And there are several letters from Jackson to O.O. Howard up at Bowdoin, which indicate a familiarity. Jackson had met with Howard, clearly he knew Howard, and he makes a suggestion to O.O. Howard. And he suggests that there were several, this map is actually from the 1820s, so this is a rather early map, but the English family had several properties. This is just three of them. They're all a couple of miles apart. The one on the lower part, the one down here, is where that mansion house was, and actually where I believe most of the time Jackson would have been sort of sleeping, shall we say. But there are other properties, including this one, notice the mill. And he writes Howard and says, I wish to inform you of something important. There is 1,000 acres of land that my master once owned with the grist mill attached, which is to be sold at sheriff's sale. The owner asks $4,000 for it. The lawyer says he cannot get it. So the people are poor. The lawyer says, now is our time. We wish to buy it for 40 freedmen that once worked on slaves on it with me for a home. I'm going to write to many of the clergymen in Europe which know me. Sorry. I'm going to ask them to collect some money for me and send it to you. If you will consent to be my agent and hold the money, I want to put all those Negroes back on it who once worked there to earn their living. I want to divide it into lots. Will you please help us out by giving us $1,000? There is now a great deal of timber on this land, which is going to waste for want of care since they have run off all the blacks. There is very truly John Andrew Jackson. The reply is held in Washington, D.C., which a clerk wrote down for Howard, saying, write that General Howard will instruct his agent to further this interesting project as much as possible, but he has no authority to donate any money for this purpose. For those of you who don't know much about Reconstruction land, there's much that is astonishing here. We have beautiful, powerful, crazy stories of some Black men and women who tried to, and sometimes succeeded, in purchasing their bankrupt former enslavers' property. My favorite example is Robert Smalls, who purchased this mansion in Beaufort on the coast, which then he lived in for many years, and which just became part of the National Park Service, I am glad to say. But so Robert Smalls did it, but he did it for himself. And there are many instances of this time of Black men and women trying to sort of purchase some land, trying to do some sort of adjacent living through the government land deed programs, creating a couple of little free Black towns, I think we can call in the South. But this is something different. Jackson is trying to create some sort of utopian 40 family collective endeavor. Again, I don't want to go deep in the history for some of you, but this is basically where the KKK started. The amount of Black violence against Black people, murders, not just threats, murders in Sumter, South Carolina alone are too numerous for me to list during the period between 1866 and 1875. The idea that Jackson possibly could have succeeded is just unthinkable. But the audacity and the beauty and the power of this attempt is astonishing and important to think of. It did not succeed. He did not manage to get the money, although the land continued to be advertised. This is cotton I took a picture of just last year, which is where that English mill house was. And it's still there being farmed. This is all, you know, hybridized, owned by international corporations, but it's still a cotton field. But let me show what happened to the grist mill. This exact site, I tried to circle around it, is the Lee County Correctional Facility, 1,792 inmates, maximum security. And this is the precise intersection, the precise place, the acreage where the land was for the mill that Jackson wanted to start a communal, safe Black settlement. That's not just ironic.
Excuse me, Professor Ashton, you asked for a time check.
I did, thanks. Okay, good, I can move along, thanks. So it's not just ironic, it's this, his engagement with carceral America is indicative again of community and breadth of the people in the context you need. That's why I have the number of inmates, because I think that's important. He goes through Connecticut speaking at various locations, lots of little advertisements. Sorry, this one's not very clear, but John Andrew Jackson is seeking to raise money. He's purchasing land. He wants to establish a home, a school for orphans. He's a man of schemes. He's a man of dreams. He's a man of hustles. His wife dies in an asylum. He marries a third wife, bringing her up from South Carolina. Seems to have a daughter named Elizabeth. He shows up all throughout Connecticut. He's arrested in North Carolina, buys more land in South Carolina, probably dies around 1899. Let me linger on two more incidents and then we'll move toward the close. In Connecticut, I did what one does. I went to the 1870 census and I found, okay, he and his wife, they're both from South Carolina. She's keeping house, he's a laborer. They're living in a Black neighborhood in New Haven, was a Black neighborhood then, now. Okay, nothing surprising there. Until I looked at the page. And in Winter Street in 1870, there are people on that page from Kentucky, Delaware, North Carolina, Maryland, and South Carolina. That's not true of adjacent pages. It's really just this page that has that breadth of geographic origin. So what's going on in 1870? If you're in Connecticut and you had been born in Maryland, South Carolina, North Carolina, Delaware, and Kentucky, you almost certainly had been an enslaved person, right? By in 1865, if you're over 5 years old, that is, right? So they maybe they had escaped, that seems unlikely. Maybe then somehow liberated by somebody else, unlikely. It seems that like after the Civil War, they made their way up. And I mention this because of the sense of community and place. Jackson and his wife, they ended up not just in New Haven, not just in a Black neighborhood where there are plenty free people of color who do, Jackson again and again, it's these free Black people of color in the North who do help him. But he's on the street, he's two houses adjacent to other fugitives, to other people who have survived. I don't wanna use the language of PTSD or trauma. I don't think those terms are quite right, but they understood each other. Later, I looked in Springfield and out of all the Black boarding houses and Black neighborhoods he could have lived in Springfield, he boarded in a house with a man who had survived slavery in Virginia. They knew each other. They sought each other out as survivors within the sort of broader protective community of the Black neighborhood in New Haven. I think we need to think again about context, of methodology, of place. There's a photograph of where his wife died. In 1881, he's arrested for obtaining money under false pretenses. This is the height of the period of time where the Southern states started picking Black men up to use on chain gangs. And poor Jackson, he's in his late 50s probably. He is sentenced to 5 years hard labor on a chain gang. And may I point out, falsely, like I know he was actually, he may have hustled some of the money on the side, but he's definitely using money. He's buying land and trying to put a school on it. He's listed, however, as escaping. Can I have a moment for this? He's like 56 years old, escaping from a chain gang? Who does that? He was listed then as recaptured. This is all I know. Then did he escape again? I don't know. But I see him back in Vermont in 1881, giving a talk. The power he must have had to survive this, to hustle, to always move forward, it's astonishing. Later in 1893, he gives a talk in Rochester, New York, which is quoted in John Blasingham's Slave Testimony, actually. He said, I came back to this country after the war. I'm getting old and feeble. I only want to live till I get the money for a home. And then I will go down to Old Caroliny, recognize that phrase, right? And there is where I want to die, down in my old cabin home. The last paper trace I'm using of Jackson is, there are a couple of land deeds in the 1880s. He's selling and buying very small pieces of land near the railroad in Sumter County, including this little part where I think he's signing it over to a relative. There's another land deed earlier in that year where he signs it over to a bunch of lawyers in Massachusetts. Sort of, I think he's returning the land that he had hoped to build a school on that they had given donations for. So that was a lot. And I'm gonna bring you to my close, to my coda, as it were. I use the phrase, my last paper trail, my last for Jackson, but that's not my last trace of Jackson, because there's a different kind of archive. There's an archive of folklore. There's an archive of Black history. There's an archive of the marginalized. And there's an archive of the memory of legacy and family. And actually, there's a WPA interview with a man named Jake McLeod of Lynchburg in 1937. And Jake McLeod was interviewed by a Black and a white interviewer hired by the government to interview the former slaves. And I nearly fell over when I saw it. I hear tell about one man running away from Black Creek and going to Free State. catch ride with people that used to travel to Charleston hauling cotton and things. He came back about 15 years after the war and lived in that place and joined me. Came back with barrels and boxes of old secondhand clothes and accumulated right smart here. He talked a great deal about how he associated with the whites. Don't know how come he run away. They didn't catch up with him till it was too late. Here are some of the barrels and boxes. These are hard to read, but these are barrels and boxes, receipts from Jackson down to Sumter County. And here is the 1898 Sumter County land deed. Jackson sold his property that was, as noted, abutting land next to Jacob McCloud. The greatest legacy of Jackson, and I believe Kelvin Smith, shout out to one of Jackson's descendants who's with us today, is his family, of course, and the truth that he spoke and the dignity and the power and the intensity he had in trying to help his people. There's a street today. I'd rather than remembering that picture of the prison or the picture of the cotton field, I'd like to show you the street sign today in Lynchburg of the Clavon family and the significance of who they are, where they are, and their claiming of place. Thank you.
Oh, it's wonderful. No, it's fabulous. Another lost Negro, lost and found. This is the lost and found department, Dwight. Founder of Lost Negroes. We keep them a repository at the Hutchins Center. It's really, really great. And you know, I love this research. And it's I'm spending a lot of time, Susanna, as everyone knows, trying to persuade my own graduate students that there's gold in them there hills called the archives. And that they could establish, in the same way that doing a dazzling close reading of Their Eyes Were Watching God 20 or 30 years ago could establish your career. Doing that again is a lot harder now, but doing that again, certainly not gonna hurt. But this archive, the archive is so rich. Dwight and I were very close. It's John Blasingame. The game is spelled, pronounced like game. And we were all at Yale together. I had breakfast with John Blasingame 6 days a week, literally. And sometimes lunch too, and sometimes dinner. You know, those days where you traveled once a year to the MLA, that was it. No celebrity status, you know. We traveled from Dwight Street to College Street where Afro M was, and then Naples Pizza Shop. And so we were with John when he was putting together slave testimony, and he did an amazing, these are my Zoom glasses and these are my progressives, because progressives make you look like that. I finally figured this out the other day. But John was trying to annotate Frederick Douglass's speeches. This is at the beginning. I mean, this is 1975, right? And he had begun the project before that. And it was full of names of people who weren't in the A and B or and all of the digitized resources that we have now. It didn't exist. In fact, my own impulse to do those big biographical dictionaries came from John. And John died before, you know, he died before the digital revolution. I mean, for him, the digital revolution was an IBM Selectric typewriter and a pool of women who could type like crazy, typing 5x8 cards and 3x5 cards over and over and over again. And he went through all the black newspapers and the reform, he called them reform newspapers, you know, the anti-slavery newspaper, collecting, indexing obituaries. And he has a zillion cards which have to be in his papers now at Duke, you know, at the John O. Franklin Center, whatever the hell it's called. But you know, they're the lives of black people still buried in these black newspapers. And then what you're doing for this colorful man can be done over and over and over again. I mean, this is just the tip of the iceberg for people who functioned, made a mark, changed things, left a testimony. And I'm doing everything I can. We now have 10,000 biographies online at the Oxford African American Studies Center, which I'm the head of. You know, we have now the African American National Biography, and then we have the Caribbean and Afro-Latin Biographical Dictionary and African Biographical Dictionary, and they're all pooled together, and there are over 10,000 names. So any way that you can, you know, we can get your graduate students, and this is for everybody, writing entries on people that you find, that people that you encounter, just send them in, because it's ever expanding. So I want to know, what do we know about, that's my pitch for the archive. What do we know now that we didn't know before about the history of Black people in Reconstruction and redemption? What year did he die?
I think 1899. Okay. I've spent a lot of time looking for him in graveyards. I'm not exactly sure.
Okay. So what do we know now that we didn't know before? I mean, one, we know about his life, which is enough. But what are the broader takeaways? I'm just curious. What surprised you? What, like, knocked you off your feet when you, I mean, looking at him lecturing in that tabernacle, what the hell the name of the
London Tabernacle.
Yeah, I mean, and then taking on Jimmy Swaggart or whatever he was, one of these, and when I looked at that preacher, he looks just like those Southern televangelists. You know, he does. Who's the guy who founded the university, who became really active in Republican politics? Very businesslike.
Not Jimmy Swaggart.
No, not Swaggart. Swaggart was one of
the Liberty University people.
Yeah, what is the university, Dwight? You know, it's the one where I've never been invited to collect an honorary degree.
Yeah. Bob Jones, one of those places.
Yeah. But anyway, that guy looks just like him to me. I mean, it looks like a type that's been passed down genetically.
Spurgeon, he actually did give, finally, he gave a speech against American slavery that inspired by Jackson, right? And then his sermons were burned in Alabama and Greenville, South Carolina, and Spurgeon, this is 1859, and Spurgeon canceled his tour of America. So that, like, he spoke out once about American slavery, there was a huge blowback in the United States, and Spurgeon canceled his tour.
It's two people, Abby, and I couldn't see who else, it's Jerry Falwell. He looks like Jerry Falwell to me,
Yes, of course.
Anyway, keep going.
Well, let's see. So what else do we know about Reconstruction that we didn't know before? I guess how much is going on behind the scenes, right? Under the white eye. If I look in the white papers of South Carolina, Jackson never shows up. Not barely ever. But as I demonstrated with Jake McLeod in Black Memory, he's there. He's there all the time. He's there making a difference. So for someone like me, who's been working in South Carolina culture and literary history for, you know, a 70-year period, just realizing how much is completely separate, right? Separate was the way to survive, really. You couldn't have any interaction with the white people in the town, in the culture, any of that at all. You couldn't let them be involved. I looked at he in the newspapers, they say, oh, he has the endorsement of so-and-so minister, so-and-so person will vouch for him in South Carolina. So you have a couple of names of white not government authority, but white ministers here and there who will vouch for him. But largely he has to operate for survival. Again, I really wanna emphasize, there were murders in Lynchburg of Black and white people by the KKK. So he really has to operate on the down low, which is why he doesn't really succeed in his dreams.
You know, I thought of my favorite example. Yours is Robert Smalls. I've been in that house, I filmed there, and I wanted to buy it. But now I'm on the board of making it, you know, into the historic, whatever the hell you call it, into a museum. But mine is Davis Bend with the Montgomery. These, for those of you who don't know, the Montgomerys were the enslaved of Jefferson Davis's brother, Joseph. And they had this massive plantation in 1867. But Ben Montgomery, I think, or his father, I forget. One of them basically took it over from the Jefferson Davis family and made it very prosperous and very successful. But ultimately, they lost it, and the Davises got it back. But that's my favorite reclamation story. I can ask you 20 questions, and that won't be fair. Krishna, would you keep me from monopolizing the conversation, please?
I will. Jim.
Let's unmute myself. That was really good. I enjoyed it a lot. I have a kind of parochial self-interested, or at least institutionally interested question, which is, how much information do you have about his time in Springfield and in Western Massachusetts? I ask that because I could envision an event that the other Du Bois place, that is the Du Bois Department of Afro-American Studies at UMass, might want to tap into your knowledge at some point.
Hey, people, I had a what next slide, and the what next is I'm happy to speak, I'm happy to learn, I'm close to the end of this project. Candidly, I need representation. I need an agent, I need a press. Thanks to the Hutchins Center, I've written 7 out of 10 chapters. It is near ending. I'm looking for, and I'm happy to come speak with other people about other aspects of this project. So just putting that all out there. Maybe later on, some of you can give me some advice. But about his experience, now I'll ask you a question. Is Worcester Central Massachusetts, and then, so if I say he went west, but I wouldn't say Worcester is like central Massachusetts. Okay.
Not to any, yeah, it's not west to anybody who lives out where I live. Let's put it.
No, but it's west of here. You know,
yes. It's west of there. So Worcester is like the center of central Massachusetts. Springfield's a big city in western Massachusetts.
He lives in Springfield.
And it's across the snow line. it snows like hell there.
Yeah, he has a lot of activity in Springfield and Worcester, both while he's a fugitive and then later afterwards. He speaks with several Black and white families. He also spends some time in Northampton. And then later, I have a newspaper article that says he was farming in Florence.
Now, well, that's part of Northampton.
Right, exactly. Although there's also a Florence, South Carolina, right near Lynchburg. Okay. So I have to say, I was like, which Florence is it? But in Northampton in the 1840s, there was a utopian community founded there that was integrated, the Northampton Association of Industry and Education, where they brought Black and white people together, supposedly in this sort of capitalist / socialist utopian endeavor that was integrated to raise silk. To raise silkworm. It didn't work out, but I have to say, I find it absolutely compelling to think that Jackson knew about that. He learned about that, and that may have informed his later plans to construct his own sort of collective timber group in
South America. I mean, Sojourner Truth was in Northampton for a while, and actually John Brown lived in Springfield for a bit. And Douglas came around pretty regularly. I mean, I've seen advertisements for the local lyceums, even where I am, you know, around Greenfield, Massachusetts, where he came. So, I mean, it would have been, you know, not just an active abolitionist community, but there was an active, you know, some history of Black abolitionism in that zone. You know, a lot of people for the 54th Regiment came from that area. And the glory, you have a fair amount of it, you know.
I got stories about Jackson. He got in a fight in Springfield with the police. He had a lot of adventures in Springfield. New. I'd be happy to talk more.
Okay, thanks. That'd be great.
Susanna, I have a regularly scheduled meeting with the president of the university, so I have to go. But I did hear that you said that you might be interested in talking about how to getting ideas about publication and agents. Well, might surprise some people. I have a little bit of experience in that area. And so just email Amy, we'll set up a Zoom. And I've been thinking about it because I was going to ask you what you're doing with this and, you know, whatever. So I'm happy to help. And I admire what you've done very, very much. I mean, really, I know John Blaskam is smiling down from heaven. So.
Well, and also just as you go, can I also just say, I in our group here, we have descendants of the English family who are with us and descendants of Jackson's family. And it's all a messy American story. And I think it takes courage and love to listen to one each other and learn from each other. And I really appreciate that they're here too, to listen and learn from you as well.
Oh, that's great. And you have brought them together in the name of their common ancestor in France.
On Zoom.
On Zoom. That's great. All right. I'll see everyone, I hope, at the lecture, the Du Bois lecture today at what time, Krista? 4 o'clock?
Yes.
4 o'clock. But Susanna, great job. And I'm sorry I got a bail.
Thank you. We can continue. I'm Mary Chapman.
Hi, Susanna. That was a great talk. I have a million questions, but the only one I want to ask you today is about the actual memoir. Do you think it was taken to many of his talks and sold? I mean, was it part of the fundraising enterprise? And what do you know about that press's affiliation with anti-slavery activism in England at the time?
That's a good question, because the answer is that press had nothing to do with anti-slavery. All it ever published were Spurgeon's sermons. It was a vanity press, basically, for Spurgeon's Baptist paperwork, which tells you something right there. So when he has the fight with Spurgeon, you can understand why he was never able to get the plates for the book or the rights to the book. He was never able to republish it again in the United States. But he did have a couple of pamphlets about America, about his experiences. And I know he would sell some of these pamphlets, that was, at his talks. Maybe he sold some of the books, but there are many newspaper articles and they don't mention the book. Many, especially in Scotland. He got arrested in Dundee. I mean, there are lots of newspaper things about his activities, and none of them mentioned the book, which I don't know what to say. There are only about 5 copies in the world, and they're sort of in random library collections across the US and England.
Thank you. Kate?
Thank you for this amazing story. It was such a narrative, juicy, lush. I heard in your talk, well, first of all, I want to say the thing about the doctor name. So you see this a lot in the Caribbean and in sort of South America as well, the use of Nganga, doc, you know, often glossed as doctor, and you see this glossed in sort of Gullah as well at different moments in time, this idea of kind of using the professional title in our language as a sort of first name. Another famous one is probably, like, you know, the leader of Palmares, Ganga Zumba, not Zumbi, but Zumba. I was curious about, I think I heard whispers of sort of like international histories in this as well. I guess I wanted to invite you to kind of dwell there for a minute, you know, thinking about Skip's invitation to sort of think about some of the larger stakes of the project. And I heard so many interesting words, you know, utopian sort of efforts and kind of circuits and these sorts of things. And I was thinking a lot about his time in Salem, where he would have interacted with seamen coming in and out, doing the copal and ivory trade out of East Africa, which was keeping Salem alive in these decades, and kind of grew over the second half of the 19th century. So I was wondering about his engagement with sort of international conversations around slavery. I mean, he's lecturing in Scotland and England, so he's aware of this. And I guess I was just curious about, you know, whether this is also part of a sort of international history of humanitarianism at this time period. I mean, this is the same time period you kind of see some of this happening around, again, the slave trade in Africa as well. So I thought I'd invite you to think about the widest frame I could come up with.
I don't like my subtitle of my title at all, but I do have the word transatlantic, sort of a working title, but I have the phrase transatlantic agitator. And I do think And it's the story with a number of enslaved people who sort of, they fall between the cracks because they don't fit in easy American or European frameworks, or, and he's one of them for that. I'll answer your question in two ways. One is easy, one is a hard answer. The easy answer is just a fun little tidbit, which is when he was working in the tanneries of Salem, which I am now an expert on the leather making industry of Salem and Peabody. And I've had to read a lot of weird books about leather in Salem. And the hides were brought from Africa on ships.
Yes.
It became the hides specifically, and they were tanned and processed in Salem. There was a huge shoemaking industry in Salem and Peabody. This is whaling is like no longer so big, and shoemaking is going up. And the shoes are made really, really cheaply and are being sold in bulk plantation labor camps in South Carolina. And so there's, you go, a triangle trade we don't often talk about. Hides from Africa, processing in Massachusetts, shoemaking for cheap shoes to be sold in bulk to field workers down in the South Carolina, right?
Salem was also part of the, you know, the ivory trade, which was going into that Connecticut River Valley that he was moving up and down, you know, the
Oh yeah.
I mean, that Salem link is really interesting. I hope it's amplified in the book.
Yeah. Well, and in terms of it, it is interesting. There's a big history to be written again about, I was trying to emphasize his independence as he's moving through England. And sometimes he's always being introduced by, you know, some white do-gooder. And he did sort of bump into some of the people who knew Douglas or anti-slavery groups a little bit. But when he gets into trouble, he says, the anti-slavery group, they never did anything for me. I never met any of those people. I never got any of their charity or their support. Where were they when I was in South Carolina? I mean, he really says that. It's powerful, visceral anger at people saying, well, I can't have you speak here because you're not endorsed by the American anti-slavery, the British or the Glasgow anti-slavery organization. He's like, what do they mean endorsed? You want to see my back? You want to see my scars? I'll show you an endorsement. And so he's got this very sort of, but he is nonetheless, in other people embrace him and invite him places and let him talk and collect money for him and help him and his wife find work, find lodging. So, you know, there is this international organizations, but they aren't, one word I'm careful about is abolition and anti-slavery, because there's, and he was certainly an abolitionist. He believed in the immediate, you know, political end to slavery. And he was speaking for the cause. He was, though, mostly collecting money to free his family. And that's different, right, from the people who are sort of speaking money for a cause more broadly. And I don't think it's less legitimate. I don't think it's less honorable. His family mattered, and they were real people. And I know what happened to many of them, and each one of them deserved to be freed in any way he could. But because of that, you know, you don't find him in sort of the political histories of the transatlantic anti-slavery movement.
Which is exactly your contribution, right? Like, he's pressing back against this very institutionalized way we've approached those histories, and that your biographical approach sort of sheds light in ways that I think historians will find really interesting.
He's not controlled by any white people.
Yeah.
That's certainly his story. He's not gonna let white people tell him where to go, what to do.
Thank you.
Michael?
Good. Well, that was, that's amazing. I find it amazing that you can, it's not only his life, but the fact that you can follow his life in so many different ways. I can't believe the amount of work that goes into this. But I do have two questions. Well, they're the same, really. One is, I wonder if you can say more about Reconstruction. And now he's trying to form some sort of collective, you call it collective cooperative. I mean, is that so uncommon in the Reconstruction period? Du Bois has a lot to say about the idea of construction. So I wonder whether you think they're really, how unique this is. And the other thing that's very stunning, ever since I heard the story for the first time, was this idea of going north on the boat, as opposed from the Underground Railroad. And And what's the significance of that? Is that really how people went north?
I'll answer the second question rather quickly, since that's an easy one. Yes, Is that how people went? That's the only way, man. You can't walk from South Carolina to freedom. Like a lot, what little we know of people who escaped is largely from testimony of people in border states, right? Frederick Douglass, God bless him, he's from Maryland. Harriet Tubman, people in Kentucky, and you know, it's people who are close to borders who could escape that way up through Ohio. People, if you're where most Black people are enslaved and in bondage is, you know, Mississippi, South Carolina, right? Georgia, you'd have to go, it's an unspeakable distance. There's no underground railroad in South Carolina or Georgia. I get furious when I hear people chit-chatting loosely about that. That's nonsensical. The very few people who escaped usually escaped by finding some mode of transportation, like a boat. That was usually the only way out. And you would either smuggle yourself aboard and just pray that you got a sympathetic captain. Jackson talks about the captain finding him and being like, somebody planted you, I'm going to get in so much trouble. If I see a ship going south, I'm going to call him over and send you back. So Jackson is terrified, but it takes the Black sailors on the boat to say, like, we got this. He won't be any trouble. We'll make this go away. So I have a whole part of my book is about getting off the boat in Boston is complicated and involves, like, you know, inspectors coming and the captain and the crew deciding whether or not to tell. So, I mean, the maritime history is only very recently have some wonderful scholars been doing work. I must say, I've been trying to figure out the boat that Jackson was on for years. It's only here at Harvard I got hooked up with some maritime people at the Peabody Essex, and they helped me understand it. And I figured out, identified the boat, I identified the captain, and gave me a whole cultural insight to why that worked. But so that's how the escapes. Back to the question about Reconstruction, how common these were. No, maybe they were common, but we don't have documentation of it. What we do know is there was, and this is not reparations by any means, but there were acts passed in Reconstruction that said, called the Land Deed Commission, where they could sell, they could arrange to sell sort of foreclosed property to enslaved people. They had to put down, you know, $10 per acre, which was not cheap, by the way, not cheap for that. They had to put down a certain amount of money. They had to promise to cultivate a certain amount of it, blah, blah, blah. And so they did have a couple of these clusters where they could buy some government land. But there were a lot of things attached to that, a lot of requirements. And it so a couple of little Black communities, free towns, did sort of consolidate. Then they'd try to build a church or a school. You know, they're trying to protect each other, basically, by being close to one another and having that collective support. But they still have individual lots. Individually, they go bankrupt or they don't. Individually, they sell off or they don't. So they're not collective in a formal organization sense. As you can tell, Jackson was actually, he was understanding a collective labor in a very particular way with one industry. And that is unprecedented, as far as I can tell, anywhere in the American South. I mean, I'm happy to be corrected, but I think it's entirely unprecedented, actually, in during this period of time.
Thank you.
David.
I just wanted to raise the question of the illustration on the title page of the volume. Is it possible to get it up on the screen?
Yes, give me a sec here. I can do that. Yeah. Sorry to make you all seasick as I go backwards. I don't know a better way to do it.
You went past it.
Oh.
You went past it. I saw it.
Almost there. It's really the only image I have of him. So
yes. Okay. But it's there. It is. Yes. I mean, it's very interesting because it's clearly a self-constructed image, and looking at it, it's full of ambiguities to me. I mean, in one sense, it suggests a kind of gentleman on horseback, sort of sporty character. It also has a kind of raffish air to it as well. It's clearly part of the publicity for the volume. And it looks full of ambiguities to me, and what he's trying to say about himself. Is he in fact saying that he's an adventurous person who, you know, heads off into the distance? And that could well be part of it. But there is also the question of control of the horse as well, that he's someone who's in some sense in control of his life. And one thing you can be sure of, that it would have been his own decision to put that image on the cover. I mean, he may have found a stock of such images and asked for it or something like that, but it's certainly something that's worth inquiring about, I think, and can be connected with the way he saw himself in the volume itself and his own way of presenting himself to the world.
Well, David, actually, later on, I'd love it if I could talk with you further about this and maybe show you like a couple of pages that I wrote, which are a close reading of this, because your experience with visual analysis is infinitely vaster than mine. I did ask a colleague who's a scholar of Black costuming and textiles, and she sort of really looked at the kind of vest and cravat and tie that he has there. It's actually a rather complicated jacket. Again, yes. This is not clothing any enslaved person would have had. And as I keep going to the checked pants, right? But it's the story he told the press, right? He's talking to the lithographer or whatever. He's talking to them about the design. It's repeated in another publication or pamphlet thing, and it's a little different, but this is basically the only image I have of him. And he clearly, his horse was his gimmick. Very few people escape on a horse, and he talks about the horse, so that's his thing. And you can get a sense, look, he talked his way out of problems his whole life. He was a raconteur. He talked, he sang. Sometimes he got himself in trouble. He got himself arrested in Dundee and Springfield and North Carolina and London. He got arrested and talked his way out of it. So you can tell he's got this charisma, this power. I agree. I find it unthinkable that he didn't control this image, that he wasn't proud of it.
Yeah.
Thank you. Are there any other questions or comments? Marwa.
Hi, thank you so much, Susanna. This was incredible. And I echo, you know, Michael's sentiments, the amount of time and care that you've taken with the archival work is just amazing and something I really aspire to. And if you're teaching a course on that, I will take it. But I wanted to think a little bit more about, it seems like you're doing some ethnographic work as well. And you talk about this community-based approach that you're using in your methodology. And I feel that you're doing that in terms of communicating with the family, the descendants, doing the sort of legwork of finding who these people are. And I wondered if you could talk about, you know, what that's like for you as a researcher and scholar. And then I wonder if that will be incorporated into your writing and into the book in any way, or if you'll take that work any further. Thank you.
Well, Marwa's question is indicative of what's important of what we do at the Hutchins Center, because I didn't know I did ethnographic work. It takes the language, right? I mean, that's because, right, we have social scientists, we have our anthropologists, we have art historians. Right? That question, Marwa, just opened a lot of doors for me. I don't have a lot of language yet around this methodology of community, but I keep thinking about that New Haven census, right? Whereby if you just look at him landing there, that's all you have. But when you look at the page, and you saw the breadth of the community, the different story it tells you. New Haven is very dear to me every time I think about that street, right? I have a little bit in my introduction where I talk about Jackson's descendants today, and particularly the Clavon name and the doctor, which is the name that I was able to trace a little bit to find to connect with his wonderful family. And my colleague here, who's a descendant of the English family, is an academic, and he found me and has also brought the stories together. So, I mean, there's so much pain in all these stories. I live and teach in South Carolina, and like many of you, I have a lot of students who are Black and white, and they aren't sure how to talk about these things. They don't want to feel guilty, God forbid. You know, they want to talk about CRT. They don't want to feel bad. Like, we all feel bad. We should all feel bad about, you know, suffering in our world. What we need to be responsible is about how, as a collective, we can do better, and how we can sort of talk with one another to move forward. So if it's ethnographic, I need to theorize it a little bit more. I need to learn a bit more about that. Sometimes I'm just stumbling. I thought I was writing a biography, and I guess that's still the label, but what I've learned is Jackson doesn't exist in a vacuum, and who he's traveling with, who he brings with him every day. It's not just the community in New Haven or the community in Springfield or the community in London. He's also carrying Louisa and Ginny with him always. Thanks.
Thank you. Well, thank you so much for bringing us the story of John Andrew Jackson. And we look forward to the book.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.